We had this lightning talk available. The speaker didn't turn up. He had some issues. So we asked a bunch of people, but then no one turned up. So Kunal will be speaking about a tool called Datasploit. It's an open source intelligence framework. Okay, so over to you, Kunal.
Hello, good evening, guys. Audible? Yeah, hello. Yeah,
what is?
Okay. Hello, better? I'll hold it like this. And yeah, okay, so here I'm to present Datasploit, an open source intelligence tool. So we are the main three contributors to Datasploit, right? So what is Datasploit?
That's got a late noise on a recording.
Okay.
Hold it up.
First time left corner, so yeah.
Okay, better now? Okay. So it's an automated OSINT framework. So basically, we have four major modules called domain, email, username, and IP. So you feed in any of these things like domain test.com, email ID, an IP address, or username. And then it fetches these informations from a lot of data sources that we have configured behind all the modules. It's completely written in Python, and currently it runs either on a console or you can export the output that's there on a JSON format. So one of the major things for the major use case for this would be a pen test, probably, because let's say for a domain you get a list of subdomains. You might be interested in, you know, finding which of those domains might be vulnerable, right? So why Datasploit? So we have a lot of information that's available open source, something like username, passwords that might be accidentally posted to GitHub, then address, email ID, phone numbers, credentials, all this information, you know, might be available accidentally or on purpose sometimes, right? So real time. So as you can see, these are some screenshots of how the information is available. If you do a Google search for, let's say, a site pastebin, you'll find some database leaks, you know, credentials that someone's done and then posted them online. Then you can either do an index of search, you know, use those Google search terms to find open indexes of different websites, then finding credentials on GitHub. So finding credentials on GitHub that have been, you know, accidentally posted. Then, so as I mentioned, we have four main components called domain OSINT. So these are the basically the four main scripts that you use to actually trigger the various data sources: domain OSINT, email OSINT, IP OSINT, and username OSINT. Then the work in progress for us is, you know, company scoping, basically, you know, making a whole profile for a company. Active modules, actually passing that information to active attack modules, then CV detail aggregation, the CV IDs that you get for modules from modules, and then auto-generated reports. So as I mentioned, we have multiple data sources. So as you can see from domain, we have about 10, 15 odd data sources. So this is how the data flows. From domain, you can get a lot of email IDs from the email harvester module. That gets passed to an email module that, again, can fetch a lot of information from these data sources. So it gets, let's say, enumerated usernames. So from those usernames, you can pass it down to get Git details, profile pictures, hashtags, the conversation that the user has been posting. And similarly, from a domain, you can get IP addresses, which you can actually pass down to find out which all ports are open and the services that are accessible. Right, so how do you set it up? So we have two modes. One is a manual mode, which includes a Git clone, which is used to set up a standalone mode as a standalone tool in itself. And the second way, how do you do it? You do a Git clone, install the requirements. There's a config.py that holds all your API keys, because these data sources that we have configured, most of them might require an API key for you to configure to actually use them. Then we have a structured folders, basically holding each of your scripts. So as you can see on the right, we have folders called domain, emails, IP, and then username. So the domain has script specific to the domain OSINT. And then we also support pip recently, so it can be installed as a Python package and be used as a library in your projects. Then we also have a Docker implementation. You just do a Docker pull, and you have Datasploit running. Then how do you write modules? It's been recently converted to a framework. So there's a single file that you call the template.py in each folder. It has three major functions: a banner, a main, and an output. So banner displays some text about the module. Main does the main logic behind you know, the module, some, you know, the processing that needs to be done. And finally, the data returned from the main is actually what gets passed to the output for printing on console in a, you know, human readable way. Then, so we have a very nice documentation, a very step-by-step documentation on how to set things up in both manual and automated ways, and then how to write in your own modules. And then the work in progress, currently we support JSON. We are planning to support HTML reports and email text files that can be, you know, passed to another tools, like emails and subdomain lists. Okay, so the demo.
Just to add to that, the documentation also has step-by-step, you know, guidelines on how to generate your API keys, how to sign up for different services which we use here.
Yeah.
It tells you exactly how, which things you have to copy and put back into the config.py.
So basically the sites you need to visit, how to sign up for them, where to get an API key and paste it in the config.py. Yeah. So,
is it visible at the back?
Yeah. So as I domain wala kaam kara domain.
No, that's fine. We can start here.
Okay. So let's say we have an IP address. You just pass it to the IP OSINT framework. You can see it first searches for Shodan. So Shodan has no information. Then virus total, whether or not this IP address was listed as a you know, compromised domain, and then some WHOIS information to get the ASN, the autonomous system number, to actually find out more related IP ranges for this.
So before we go ahead, like suppose if you have got an email address, okay, you're tracing someone and you've got an email address, what kind of information would you like to collect about an email? Any pointers?
Organization.
Yeah.
Anything else you would like to like find out about a person? You've got an email ID of a person.
Yeah.
Password.
Yeah, good. Sorry, what was that?
True name.
Good. Exactly.
So what we are trying to do with Data Exploit is, you know, it's no rocket science. We're just, the things which you'll do manually, going on one site and finding out information, we're just collecting a bunch of such sites, calling those APIs, getting it sorted, like it goes in an automated manner. That is the difference which Data Exploit brings in comparison to other tools, because a lot of other tools, you know, they, nice. That's funny. Yeah, so a lot of other tools, you know, they are really good, but one thing which I really miss in other tools is like they do not have an automated approach. You have to manually pick and use things. Sometimes you don't really know what modules you should use. I mean, for a person who do not do OSINT on a daily basis, it becomes very difficult.
Yeah.
So that's the problem we are trying to solve here. We are trying to do everything in an automated manner. So even if you do not know anything about OSINT, just configure your config.py, and it will do the things for you.
Yeah, so it gathers the relevant information, displays them all in a very clear text format. So as he mentioned, so let's say you get a domain test.com and you need to find out what all information is available. We have all this information, Punk Spider, the DNS records that are there, the email address harvested related to that domain. So these email addresses you might be interested. So let's say you find the combination of first name, last name. So you can figure out what kind of format the organization uses to actually name their employees. Then you can, you know, actually brute force them. So after this, then you get, so basically where all this domain has been mentioned on GitHub. So let's say files where, you know, there might be username passwords or AWS keys, let's say, suppose. So you can see the files, the specific file where this domain name was seen. And okay, and then some page links, then the paste bin. So as you can see for test.com, you can have something like email ID and then a password. So probably this email ID password will mostly work on different websites that you find related to this email ID.
So finding things on GitHub and Pastebin is something which I always do in my pen test, you know. So whenever I'm doing a pen test, I come across any domain name, I always make sure that I search these things on GitHub and Pastebin. So you never know, sometimes you might directly get a DB connection string, or you might get a domain credential. So you don't even need to exploit a vulnerability. Yeah. So it gets pretty easy for me. So yeah.
Then, so that domain then gets searched on Shodan for, you know, the ports that are open. As you can see, so you might find something like open an SSH open on a IP address related to test.com. So that might be exploitable. And then all that information, AD, 443, what services are running, what's the geolocation for that. And then So that's like a lot of information. Then the subdomains that are there. As I mentioned, this might be interesting for a pen tester guy to actually find subdomains that are there and might be exploitable. Then,
so not only pen tester, but even if you are running a company, yeah. you are managing security
your own
for your company,
domains.
You can check your parameter. Like what also, sometimes what happens is there are some legacy subdomains like abcd.xyz.com, and you are not aware of them. And so most of the time, legacy code is very much vulnerable to things, yeah. and it gets very easy to pop up a shell out of it. You know, so it's probably worthwhile checking all the domains which are lying out.
And then we also search that domain for any WikiLeaks documents that are related to that domain. And then Zoomai, similar to Shodan, gets all that IP-related information, the services that are running, the header information that gets returned from those IPs. Then the next module we have is a email OSINT.
Yeah, it's a wrong one. Okay. I pass a username.
So let's say a username, you get a username, and so Keybase is a very good source of information where, you know, a user actually has to verify his own accounts. So the information you get here is actually the, you know, the profiles that it belongs to the same user. So you won't find, you know, data that is mismatching or let's say false positives, right? So here, this might be a very good information to find out all that accounts that are listed for this user. So let's say you found this username previously on, let's say, a Pastebin and has a username password combination in a Pastebin document. You can go ahead on these sites and try that out. So obviously, that, you know, opens up a very good opportunity for you.
And another thing which this could be used is, like, a lot of people, you know, verify their devices and they leave their device name as they are. So what happens is you can actually use those device names to launch a phishing campaign or, you know, trick the user, you know, to get into to do something stupid.
And so, so as I mentioned, we also allow you to,
So it's like we're not grabbing from anywhere else. The person generally verifies their devices on Keybase. So the Keybase have an open API. You don't even need authentication for that. So it's pretty easy to get it out.
You're doing a lot of stuff with like public dumps and all this cross correlation. How are you verifying that any of this data is still fresh?
Okay,
like,
so that's a valid thing. I mean, so as of now, we are completely relying on information which exists online.
So, but I guess I'm just curious. Like, are you doing active checks, or are you just
As of now, no. Because, you know, we thought of doing that, but it becomes really tricky to verify, because we will have to do a lot of correlation.
Finding.
We have to do match images and stuff.
So you make, like, a best effort.
Right now we are making the best effort, but we are trying to work on those things. Yeah.
Follow-up question. Are you doing anything to actively notify users that you're leveraging their
data? Exactly. So if you, we'll be coming on the roadmap. That those things are in the roadmap. So you can, schedule the things. Okay. No, we don't have as of now.
That's awesome. Sorry.
That's fine.
So as I mentioned, we also support Datasploit as a library. So let's say if you do a simple import Datasploit, you have it available to use in your own Python project. And let's say if you do a Datasploit, I'll just show a quick demo for it, .username. That's our main module for, user name. And then let's say the module that's in there is called username_gitscrape. Right, and then we have a main function for each module that needs to be implemented. And then you pass in the actual username. Let's say I'll pass in my colleagues.
Oh, that's not going to use anything. That might yield something about double A. Yeah, just single A.
Oh, so user, typo. User, what's happening to your keyboard?
I don't know. You just messed it up.
Okay, so he hasn't defined any API keys for it, but let's say if he had, you'll have that data returned to you in a native Python object, probably a dictionary, a list, whatever, you know, is relevant to that module. So for GitScrape, you'll probably find the repositories that the user have, and in those, you'll find the commits. So you can find out which all are the most active, repositories that the user contributes to, and probably in that, you can find something, you know, similar like a password username combination that might be there. And then the last one might be, so similarly, So rather than using the consolidated script called domain OSINT or even email OSINT, the individual modules themselves are callable. You can just say a Python domain, then the specific module that you need to call, domain subdomains.py, and then just pass in the domain name that's there. You'll find all the specific subdomains that are there.
Okay, so for subdomain, right now we are using DNS dumpster, we are using Netcraft, and we are using certificate transparency from Google. And we plan to introduce LDNS walking right later on, but that's in the plan.
Yeah, so most of the APIs might have a throttling there. So they obviously return, rate limit exceeded, something like that.
And here's this one script called emailosin.py.
No?
Okay, I'm sorry.
Sorry, was that your, what you're asking?
Are you making an effort to subvert
that? So we can't, but obviously we can, get in touch with the,
specific.
Yeah, exactly.
So about the emailosin, this is what we do.
So the
very first thing, it will check for some basic things. For example, if you are running a phishing campaign, it will tell you whether it's a disposable email or not, whether this domain can receive emails or not. So if you are trying to send emails, it will tell you those things. It will tell you search information from Clearbit. It will tell you a bunch of information about the person, the name, the tentative location, or the profile, or whatever things.
So as mentioned by you, so for an email, you get the true name that's there, the usernames that are there.
Then it goes to full contact. We are not relying on just one source. There is another source called full contact. We're using them. It tells you the name. It tells you the designation of the person, social profiles. We have got like 500 profiles which we check for, but we are trying to get more. And then Twitter, and it will download all the images from these respective places. What you can do is you can use these images to do Google reverse image search and stuff, so you can get more information. Then it goes and check on have I been pawned, whether this email ID was a part of a compromise or not. So as you see, if my email ID was part of 3 compromises, so what you can do is you can go back to other places where you can get these database dumps. You might get correct CRUD hashes or passwords, and then there might be chances that I'm using the same password somewhere else. So it gets an easy win. It checks for paste on other places.
Pen.
Right now my API key is expired, so yeah. And then
so
script
that's
documents.
Probably what you were asking, right?
Slideshare.
When API send us a forbidden.
Slides, any slides which I published, and associated subdomains for me. So this is the information which you are getting from email ID. I think that's it. That's what we have for the demonstration. We have a Twitter account called DataSprite where we post in tweets and announcement about this.
Yeah.
The same feed goes into Facebook.
Facebook also.
This is the small roadmap which we think of. We plan to, if we are not lazy, we'll try to get this coded.
So
and,
right now it's like an ad hoc tool, so you run it as and when you want. So probably you want to integrate it with automated tools. So you want, let's say, an incremental change that's happening to find out the difference between a previous run and a next run, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's a dumb question or not. Any plans to integrate any kind of a
Multigo
type transform or anything like that?
Yeah, we can. I mean, we can. What we can do, I mean, there's no point writing the same code for Multigo because anyway, we are writing in our tool. But what we can do is, we can write code which generates an output which could be directly used by Multigo. I mean, that will be a better way. Otherwise, there's no point reinventing the wheel, right?
Right.
So yeah, we can work on that lines. So far, the tool has been covered on multiple places, but I don't want to brag about it right now.
Yeah.
But the point I wanted to raise is how you can contribute. You can test the tool. You can write blogs about the tool.
Since it's a framework, we encourage you to actually go through the framework that's there and actually implement the functions. So write modules, send us a pull request, we'll try to integrate it there.
Yeah. So we are the core contributors. I'm Shubham, Sudhanshu, Kunal, and Nutan is missing. He's in the other room. And if you've got any questions, please shoot. That's it. Thanks.